Chapter 7. Toad Meets the Rebellious Child. In the week before the next session, Toad thought a great deal about his own anger, and on the whole found that he linked it with feelings of guilt. Apart from his father, the person who had been most angry with him in his adult life had been Badger. Badger, that large, strong animal who, ages ago, had tried to stop him enjoying motor cars, and had spoken to him so sternly that he had shed bitter tears of remorse and promised to reform, and a lot of good that had done. Toad realized with a flash of insight that Badger could never be a counsellor, because he never listened. Like all angry people, he wanted to tell others what to do, and then criticize them for their shortcomings. Toad remembered and relived and reviewed one particular situation with Badger. It had happened some years ago, when he had been going through a rather difficult time. He had had one or two nasty car crashes, when one day, out of the blue, Badger descended on him with rat and mole, and proceeded to try and make him change his life. He remembered Badger taking him into the smoking room at Toad Hall and giving him the severest of moral lectures, reducing Toad to penitence and tears. But when it was over and the severe Badger became a more kindly father figure, Toad's natural resilience had reasserted itself. At the time, Badger wanted him to confess his sins to Rat and Mole and publicly admit the error of his ways. But of course he wouldn't. Toad remembered the situation perfectly and recalled his exact words.
"No," he said, "I'm not sorry. And it wasn't folly at all, it was simply glorious,"
he had added impatiently when Badger appeared scandalized at his words.
"Oh, yes, in there, I would have said anything, in there."
And so he would, for Toad realized that his apparent penitential response had been, in fact, a defense against Badger's attack. It certainly had not come from the heart, and it did not represent a true change. "But," thought Toad, "there I go again. It's always someone else who gets angry, never me. I wonder why." Eventually the counselling day came round again, and Toad found himself once more facing his counsellor in the familiar room at the heronry. "Good morning, Toad," commenced the heron. "How are you in your spirits today?"
"I'm feeling a bit happier, I think," replied Toad. "I'm sleeping better and taking a keener interest in things. For instance, I have started to take a daily paper again, and I really read it. At one time I just couldn't be bothered to open one."
"That's very good," the heron responded. "And where would you say you are on our feelings thermometer?" He rustled through the flip sheets and turned up the diagram, which he had drawn at their first meeting. It was simply a vertical line with 1 at the bottom and 10 at the top.
"I think I feel about 5 or 6, said Toad.
"And can you see where you were at our original meeting?" asked Heron, and he pointed to where Toad had placed his mark all those weeks ago. It was between 1 and 2. There was a pause which Toad experienced as quite a friendly silence, as they looked at each other. Eventually Toad spoke.
"Heron," he said, "am I allowed to set the agenda for this meeting?"
"Of course you are. I shall be delighted if you do," answered Heron. "But in a real sense, you have always set the agenda.
At each of our meetings, I have always attempted to help you work on those issues which will provide you with the greatest insights and learning. If you are now able to identify these yourself, then we are really making progress."
"Well," answered Toad, "I want to analyse my own anger, or more correctly, my lack of it. At our last meeting, we looked at how I had adapted my behaviour to cope with my critical parents, and you called this compliant behaviour."
"Yes, I remember," said Heron. "It's still on the flip chart." He selected the page headed Compliant Behaviour, underneath which was written Agreeing, Pleasing, Apologising, Dependency. "I suggested this was how you defined yourself from your parents' anger and aggression. So what is your question, Toad?"
"It's really quite simple, but I can't find the answer. Why don't I get angry, that's all?"
"Have you ever been angry?" asked Heron.
"Well, never like Badger. When he's angry, he looks stern and severe, and his voice gets loud and angry, and he points his finger at you. I tell you, he can frighten the life out of me."
"Are you never like that?" asked Heron.
Toad thought hard. "I suppose there was one time. That was when my friends and I fought the wild wooders who had occupied my house. I was so angry I uttered war whoops and went straight for the chief weasel. I whacked him really hard and drove him out along with the rest of them. But that was a very unusual situation. When it was all over, I felt so tired I couldn't get up the next day until lunchtime. It was very much against my nature. I'm not really a fighter, but I have to say that I am proud of what I did on that evening. In fact, very proud."
"You have every right to be," said Heron warmly.
but I still do not know exactly the issue which is concerning you. Can you state your question more precisely?
Yes, I can, said Toad. A couple of sessions ago you said, and I agreed with you, that anger is one of our basic emotions. I recall you said that these basic emotions are like the primary colours on an artist's palette. So my question is, if anger is a basic constituent of my behaviour, why don't I get angry?
That really is an excellent question, Toad, said Terran. However, like all good questions, the answer is likely to give you possibly painful insights into yourself. Are you ready for this?
Toad looked steadily at Heron.
I have gone this far, he said. I can't stop now.
Right, said Heron.
Perhaps the best way to begin is to use our brains and our reason, even though the question is all about feelings and emotion. Let us start by imagining the following situation. You are being held captive by benevolent despots. They have complete dominion over you, yet at the same time, they look after you and take care of you. How would you feel about that?
I think I would have very mixed feelings about them, said Toad.
Exactly. And that's what you experienced when you were little. How could you be angry with these kindly despots, your parents, who clearly had the upper hand, and on whom you were totally dependent, and whom you loved?
Toad sat very still, deep in thought.
It does seem to be a genuine dilemma, he said. So what would have happened when the force of my anger met the apparently invincible power of my parents?
It seems to me, said Heron, that there can be only one possible answer.
And what is that? Asked Toad.
You had to learn how to be angry, non-aggressively. But that's impossible, Toad replied quickly. Surely being angry means being aggressive, by definition. Isn't it more likely that I learned to suppress my anger totally?
I doubt that very much, answered Heron.
Anger is such an integral part of our behaviour that it can never be totally suppressed. Let's use another metaphor, this time from science. Imagine a cylinder of gas which has started to heat up. The pressure is increasing and there is a danger of an explosion. What could be done quickly to reduce the pressure?
The first thing you could do, answered Toad, and the most obvious, is open the valve as far as possible and vent the gas to the atmosphere in a great powerful jet.
Quite so, said Heron. And this is just how some people learn to deal with their anger. They release it like a powerful jet of gas directed at a chosen target, and then resume their normal behaviour. What they forget, or deliberately avoid noticing, is the damage they caused and the adverse effect this behaviour has on their relationships.
So anger is aggressive, like I said?
Asked Toad, anxious not to lose his point.
Yes, it certainly is in this example. And that is what I wanted to illustrate. But now consider this. Think once again about that gas cylinder getting hot and the pressure building up inside. Is there another way to reduce the pressure, perhaps less dramatically?
I suppose if you wanted to be more careful, you could simply open the valve slowly and let the gas seep out over a period of time.
Is that what you were thinking?
Indeed it is, said Heron. Don't you see, Toad? You are discovering the answer. What you and many other people have learned is how to be angry non-aggressively. You adopted ways of letting your anger out slowly and gently, almost imperceptibly, so as not to upset anyone.
But how? Asked Toad plaintively. I can't remember behaving like that.
Well, said the Heron,
do you remember ever throwing a tantrum?
What? Is that really anger? Asked Toad in some surprise.
I mean, tantrums are really pointless and I don't achieve anything.
My dear Toad, Heron said patiently, that's just the point. Tantrums are a childish display of anger, often as a response to someone saying, no, you can't, to a child. This makes the child very angry, yet at the same time it feels powerless to be violent or aggressive towards the person who has caused their anger. All it can do is lie on the floor and kick and scream. When adults do this, it's sometimes called throwing a wobbly.
Said Toad. I suppose I've thrown a few of those in my time, but, he added, not recently.
Then he continued, you said that these forms of non-aggressive anger were spread over time. A tantrum may not last very long.
That's true, answered Heron, although some tantrums can go on for a long time. Let's think of a response that can last for hours and even days.
Like what? Asked Toad.
How about sulking?
Sulking? Repeated Toad.
I never thought of sulking as a way of being angry.
Well, I believe it is, replied Heron. Sulking is a sullen, morose behaviour where the sulker is unusually quiet. I think, Toad, that of all the adapted child behaviours, sulking is the best illustration of using time to reduce the force of anger. It is usually a child's response to authority when they can't get their own way. In adults, it often happens for the same reason, perhaps when someone has lost a power struggle. Sulking is essentially a loser's response to the more powerful winner. It achieves just what we've been talking about. It reduces the force of anger by releasing it gradually at a very low level of intensity. And this, of course, reduces the aggression. There was a long silence as they both thought about this. Toad was beginning to realize that more and more of his behavior originated from his adapted child. Heron was trying to recognize how far Toad was understanding these issues and asking himself whether he, the Heron, was doing too much of the talking. Eventually, Toad asked, "Are there many other ways in which a child learns to be angry?" "I'm sure there are hundreds," Heron replied. "When you think about it, each of us must adapt to the particular circumstances of our childhood. It is like a great mosaic of behavior, with all the associated feelings and emotions." "So, can I ask you how you analyze them?" Toad asked. "Certainly," answered Heron. "Let me draw you a diagram." And this is what he drew. How a child releases its anger. An arrow from weak to strong. And at the bottom, withdrawing, being bored, delaying, moping, petulance, sulking, tantrums, rebellion. Then he continued, "Of course the point is, and I know you're beginning to realize this, Toad, that all of these behavioral strategies are in effect defense mechanisms developed in our childhood to protect us from the dangers we perceived then, real or imaginary. When we see adults sulking and throwing tantrums and moping about and saying they are bored, we may wonder if their behavior is appropriate, whether they are compelled, yet again, to act out their childhood." "Well, what's so wrong with that?" asked Toad petulantly, who felt that he was being got at by Heron. "We can all be a bit childish at times, can't we?" "There's nothing wrong about it in any moral sense," answered Heron. "Analysis is not judgmental, but these kinds of behaviors have two consequences, both negative. The first is that they invite ridicule. Seeing a grown person having a tantrum or sulking can be very amusing as well as embarrassing, but more significantly, these behaviors demonstrate and reveal the loser." "That makes me feel very bad," said Toad. "We do all this work, and the result is that I feel I have been stupid for a lot of my life. What can I do, Heron? When am I going to learn how to be grown up?" "How about at our next meeting?" said Heron, and with a smile, he showed Toad to the door.